Love it.
I'll promote whatever you got.
All right.
Welcome, Earthlings, to the latest episode of the Wreak Havoc Film Bus Podcast. I am your host, Dan Sellers, along here with my jolly co-host, Mr.
Sammy Castle.
we are very excited here to have today an industry pro, Mr. Tom Ackerman.
Honored.
We're very honored.
The honor is mine.
Yeah.
Tom, can you tell our audience a little bit about yourself and your career?
Well, I was born in a place not unlike North Carolina, mm-hmm. except it was in the Midwest, Iowa. No movies were being made mm-hmm. At all, anywhere nearby. But I did have a dad who was a projectionist at the Times Theater. Mm-hmm. And so my introduction to movies came as a kid up in the projection booth, seeing virtually everything that came to town. And that was before the day of R ratings, so you could see everything that came to town as a child.
You're dating yourself.
Yeah, tell me about it. But then eventually I connected the dots, and a love of theater, a love of still photography, and of course the exposure to, if you will, the exhibition side of movie making, really created a desire to get there professionally. Now, again, Iowa, and I went to the University of Iowa, mm-hmm. which had a great theater department, but no, and some film courses, but nothing anywhere near going to USC, UCLA, mm-hmm. Or any other one of the many distinguished film programs that are available now.
Yeah.
So that was where I started. I got my first break, in a sense. In the Air Force. I was in Air Force ROTC in college. Vietnam was whipping up into a very serious matter. Yeah. And I was lucky enough to be assigned as a motion picture production officer.
Really?
Which meant that I put on the uniform and I made movies all day. Now, that also entailed a mandatory trip to Southeast Asia. I went over twice. Vietnam for 2 months, Thailand for 10 months, where I was a detachment commander mm-hmm. of a photographic unit in support of a tactical fighter wing. And yet, in the course of all that, I got enough experience mm-hmm. and enough contacts, more mm-hmm. importantly, probably, that segued into a job post-Air Force working with Charles Guggenheim in Washington, mm-hmm. multi-Academy Award-winning documentarian. Mm-hmm. No one has won more Oscars for his documentary work than Charles, who passed away about 10 years ago. Mm. So that solidified the base even further and led to a partnership in L.A. Mm-hmm. with an Air Force buddy, Mike Robe. We hung out our shingle 1973 and had no expectation of failing, but the odds were seriously against us. This is a time when Hollywood and the unions and everything else were totally locked up. Mm-hmm. But we naively thought that, well, we can do it. We're excited, and we know how to make movies, and rented a suite of offices, and fortunately, unaware of the daunting prospects ahead of us, but it all worked out. We did well. We mm-hmm. did well economically, creatively. He wrote his first screenplay. I got into the union, and things fell into place.
Wow.
It helps to not know the odds.
That is an awesome story. Yeah,
that is.
And thank you for your service.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I have a lot of family who are ex-military, and so it's, I always appreciate people that. And for anybody that had to actually go to Southeast Asia, it amazes me that y'all could.
Well, I was one of the lucky ones, obviously, and more than just being able to do a job that I was so committed to, and that proved to be a gateway to my future employment. But I came back in one piece. Mm-hmm. Others didn't. Did I get shot at? Yep. It was scary, yes. And planes did crash every now and then. And that was a sobering experience to be around. But it was not until I was shooting for the George McGovern campaign in 1972 with Charles Guggenheim, and we went into a veterans hospital, a VA hospital ward out in Milwaukee with the candidate, who had himself been a decorated B-24 mm-hmm. pilot during World War II, mm-hmm. flew his 25 combat missions, and acquitted himself very, very well. Mm-hmm. He talked to the vets in that hospital ward for about 2 hours. I saw guys my age, quadriplegics, paraplegics, all manner of devastating injuries that they had sustained in that ward. And I was busy shooting, right, hand-holding an Eclair NPR, shooting roll after roll mm-hmm. with the candidate. But walking out, it was a very unnerving first confrontation, believe it or not, that could be me. When you're young and you're in a war, oftentimes you're either just scared out of your brain or you're so naive that it's unreal and it won't happen to you.
Yeah.
When I saw those guys, it was clear that I'd been a lucky fella.
Yeah.
Wow.
So anyway.
Since we have started off in this very serious conversation, and most of our listeners know me as someone who is not serious whatsoever, this sounds very much like Full Metal Jacket.
Which we talked about on the podcast.
Yeah. Was Full Metal Jacket based on you?
No, and as far as being serious is concerned, as far as seriousness, I would say that... my career, as you know,
yes.
has included a lot of comedy.
Yes.
Work. And I've been so lucky to work
Absolutely.
With the masters
yes.
of comedy from the Zucker brothers, both Jerry and David. obviously, Adam McKay mm-hmm. and Will Ferrell on Anchorman. Where the occupational hazard actually, in Vietnam it was getting shot at, on the set of Anchorman, it was not laughing during a take and ruining it. You sit over in Video Village.
That'd be hard for everyone in the scene and not in the scene, but behind the camera to do with those guys. Well, tell our audience what a couple other things you've worked on over the years.
Well, I was fortunate to work with Tim Burton on two films. The first opportunity was the live-action first rendition of Frankenweenie.
Frankenweenie, yeah.
That was really the film that launched Tim mm-hmm. and put him in a spotlight that was bright enough to get him Pee-wee's Big Adventure. The film was... Disney was scared of what really? Frankenweenie became.
Yeah.
They were intending to release it with, I forget which, feature film comedy mm-hmm. That holiday.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just... They were freaked out about the film, and actually it never was released theatrically,
yeah.
As far as I know, except for maybe Academy Award consideration.
Yeah.
But it eventually made it out on the Nightmare Before Christmas boxed set
oh, really?
DVDs. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a nice transfer, too.
Yeah.
But it certainly launched Tim, and it gave us a chance to work together and get to know each other. I didn't work... I shot a few days on Pee-wee's Big Adventure, but I still didn't quite have the studio cred
mm-hmm.
to be assigned as the director of photography on that. Victor Kemper mm-hmm. took over as Victor, or was assigned by Warner's to do that job. But by the time Beetlejuice rolled around, I had just shot my first big studio film, Back to School,
mm-hmm.
the Rodney Dangerfield classic that was so brilliantly directed by Alan Metter, and it was one of the 10 top grossing films of the year. So now, okay, he can do it.
Hey, yeah.
It will allow
yeah.
him to
a little bit of cred.
Take the reins. Yeah, a little bit of cred.
Yeah.
And then Beetlejuice just took it and said, psh.
Yeah, yes, Beetlejuice came up, and Tim asked me to work on it. I got the script before the deal was set, and this was before Michael Keaton had been cast.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Now imagine what it would have seemed to be on the printed page.
Mm-hmm.
If you got the script,
mm-hmm.
it was weird,
bizarre, I'm sure.
And it was before we had talked in any detail or depth about what the vision of the film would be. Mm-hmm. It was pre-Michael Keaton.
Yeah.
And in fact, I think it's pretty well known, though, by a limited number of people, that there was another actor that was really at the top of Tim's short list before Michael was cast. Mm, do you know who that was?
No.
Sammy Davis Jr.
Really?
That would be in a decidedly different...
That sounds familiar, like way back in the...
That's been a completely different movie.
Yeah, you can verify it in other sources. There were a few years where I thought, I hope I'm not conjuring this up. I mean, maybe it's one of those urban legends that I'm... You know, it never happened. But no, he was... And if you read that original script, or in fact the final shooting script, the lounge lizardy, smarmy guy coming on to a little girl.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not, by the way, suggesting that Sammy Davis would, but a lounge lizard type. Mm-hmm. Sammy Davis could have played.
Yeah, I can see that. Wow, that would be such a different film.
It would be. That's the fun thing about movies. They can take twists and turns,
absolutely.
And they become something idiosyncratic and organic to themselves.
And I mean, he had some acting cred going on, too, and some comedy acting cred. So, I mean, it would have been a different movie, but that doesn't necessarily mean it wouldn't have been a good movie.
Night Shift, you ever seen that one?
Yes.
That's great.
But I was thinking Cannonball Run.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I love the stuff he did in Cannonball Run.
Are you talking about Sammy?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I was talking about Michael Keaton.
Oh.
Now, I had, at the time, I was really... Things were the trajectory, the career trajectory was really ascending at a marvelous rate, and so I had actually another feature offer on the table. I was also very busy shooting commercials at that time, but another major studio film was on the table. I'm not going to mention the principals involved, but it was a backlot comedy, funny script. Very, very much the type of project that, coming off of Back to School, I might have said, yeah, I think I'm going to do that one, because it was part of the same kind of front office guaranteed results kind of project.
Mm-hmm.
But, and that offer was pretty much on the same, was on the table at the same time. But the experience of working with Tim, and by that time we'd gotten to know each other fairly well, was such that I felt like taking a chance.
Mm-hmm.
I did it for less money, not a lot less, but I did it for less money, and based on a screenplay that was so weird that I had no confidence. I didn't think it wouldn't do well, but I didn't have the same feeling as I did about the other project.
Mm-hmm.
As it turns out, that was just another ordinary backlot comedy. And Beetlejuice, again, became one of the top 10 grossing movies of the year. And for reasons that were not imitation, but innovation.
Mm-hmm.
It was a film like no other.
Mm-hmm. So what made you make that decision? Was it the script? Was it his ideas? Was it his personality?
Working with him in the past?
Yeah, or
knowing how
the familiarity. Thank you.
It was that. that sounds like
amateur actor. I can't get.
Yeah, no, it was all of those things that you mentioned.
Okay. I think it's fair to say, I mean, there's probably hardly anything else out there like that, even in script form. I mean, not a whole lot floating around. Opportunities like that.
Well, it was. I will. You know, photographically, it was an opportunity to work with Tim, to photograph something that was really another world.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that doesn't just mean, well, we'll make it colorful and crazy and kooky, and we'll. It was. You know, when you create another world on film, that is very different from this one, you have to do it with some. Prevailing logic. In other words, you can't just do nutty stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There has to be some kind of an arc to what you do.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, with Bo Welch and his brilliant production design and Tim at the helm, we came up with something that ultimately was fashioned into the world of Beetlejuice.
Yeah.
And the fact is, it was this very convoluted, strange world in a Norman Rockwell New England landscape.
It's like something otherworldly intruding upon the real world, or actually a more Norman Rockwellian, yeah.
Which is what Burton has now kind of become famous for, yeah, with that and Edward Scissorhands.
Oh, he's very good at it.
Yes.
And he is truly an artist. I have a set of hand-drawn, they're not the originals, but I have a complete set of Frankenweenie storyboards.
Oh, really?
That Tim did. And you see it, and they are, you know, line drawings, mm-hmm, pen and ink, mm-hmm, but they leave no doubt as to the fact that this person has vision.
Yeah,
they have a flavor and a feeling.
Yeah,
that's unmistakable.
It's distinct to them.
Very distinct.
Yeah. Okay. Well, one thing I've been dying to ask you about. I'm familiar with you from Project Greenlight. now you haven't seen that, have you, Sam?
No.
He was the DP on Battle for Shaker Heights, and I'm a big fan. I've watched every season of that show. Just it's so interesting to me to see how all the moving parts come together. And I'm as someone who actually worked on the film, I'm dying to know how realistic of a portrayal is the show to the real thing. Did they leave a lot out? Did they misrepresent things in your opinion? Or,
well, I think as far as leaving or including, mm-hmm, material, as far as representing or misrepresenting, I think one has to realize that all reality TV, in order to sell advertising, mm-hmm, and attract an audience,
sure,
very importantly, it's not just craven advertising interest, but sure, let's face it, if somebody's going to, you know, log on or tune in, mm-hmm, to watch reality TV, mm-hmm, they want story.
Sure.
Story is conflict.
Mm-hmm.
Story is surprise
drama.
Endings and drama.
A lot of conflict on that season.
Now, and that's the only reality show experience that I've had, and, mm-hmm, I didn't shoot it. Obviously, I was, yeah, on the other end of the camera,
yeah,
for a change. But I can tell you that in some respects it was an accurate portrayal.
Mm-hmm.
In others, it was a contrivance.
Yeah.
In others, it was outright misrepresentation.
Really?
All of the above.
But I think my feeling, and I've continued to work, I'm friends with both the directors, and I've worked with Kyle Rankin, as you probably know, on a couple of, mm-hmm, other movies. And I think that the deal you make, if you are going to win a contest and go on Project Greenlight,
mm-hmm,
and get a major studio to release the movie, to get a union crew, mm-hmm, to get SAG, mm-hmm, actors, mm-hmm, and a decent schedule. You know, it's a 21, 22-day schedule, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to realize that the story of the making of the film may not be told as you would like it to be.
Sure.
And I think what made Kyle and Ephraim particularly targetable,
mm-hmm,
by that show was the fact that there were two of them. Mm-hmm. There were two directors. If you're directing the movie and there's five cameras swarming trying to, and an overarching need to create a story arc, well, if you're thinking about something, musing,
mm-hmm,
none of the five cameras can look inside your brain. Now,
yeah,
now that will be extracted in an interview at a later date, mm-hmm, maybe, or maybe not. but when you have two directors, it's like they're narrating their own, they're talking to each other.
Mm-hmm.
There are a couple of moments that looked silly,
mm-hmm,
because there were two, you know, one goes up to one side of the car to talk to the actor. The other one runs up, and they have to roll down the other side window to talk.
Remember that?
You remember the wedding sequence?
Uh-huh, in the limousine.
Yeah, in the limo, and it's an iconic moment for the show.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? That's not
representative.
It's not representative. A and B. Yeah. If you've spent any time on a motion picture set,
mm-hmm,
you know that there are many such moments.
Sure.
The question is not whether there are the moments in which any of us sitting at this table might look a little, not foolish, but not in control.
Mm-hmm.
There are lots of opportunities. So,
well, they have the benefit of being able to cherry pick what they want out of all of the footage and present their narrative, of this production and pre-production filled with conflict between the directors and the writer and even the producers coming in, and they're all just at each other's heads, and poor Tom comes in, they're all like, yeah, let's hire him. And then they get right back to the conflict.
Oh, yeah, and on with the conflict. No, and speaking of pre-production, there was one sequence, I'm sure you remember it, where I was in a production meeting with the directors, and I think Jeff Bayless, whom I've worked with on a couple of projects since. Yeah, Jeff is great. He produced a music video that Shia directed. And another video. We did two videos with Shia a few years ago.
That's pretty cool.
But the occasion was a production meeting, and Chris Moore comes in, and I don't know if he introduced the topic, but in any case, the topic of car promotion came up.
Mm-hmm.
You remember that?
I think so. Yeah.
And the way it was cut made it seem as if Ephraim was lobbying in a very overt and sort of unseemly way for a BMW.
Yeah.
Yes.
And the way it looks is that he was not being diligent in this very important. Every moment, every single minute of pre-production is gold. You can't.
Sure.
Now this guy's talking about how he wants a car. Okay, well the background is that they had already given a BMW convertible, or for the use of the show, for the run of the show, to Erica, mm-hmm. the writer. And so if you were there, and Erica got her BMW, wouldn't you? Ephraim, they were driving these junkers, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
You'd say, hey, LA is a big place.
You got to drive everywhere.
You got to drive everywhere. Yeah. We're going to be driving to and from mm-hmm. work. I don't know if they had Teamsters taking them to set. I don't recall. But it was a legitimate, reasonable question.
Yes.
In the real context. As edited, it looked like a craven egomaniac demanding transportation when he should have been talking about the movie.
Yeah.
And I guess,
totally fake.
Well, we'll move on from this, but I'm just, as a big fan of the show, I just, you said you win this contest and it's really a marvelous opportunity, but at the same time it seems like you're kind of shooting yourself in the foot. When you watch some of these episodes, you're like, wow, I don't know how, after seeing this, who's going to hire you to do something, to write this or to direct that, once they've seen you have this episode. And maybe that's kind of a common thing for I just, not everyone has their behind the scenes moments aired out for their dirty laundry aired out to see.
I think one would ask themselves that question mm-hmm. if one were not receiving the offer to do that mm-hmm.
yeah.
production. And I think we also, each one of us, has the ability to convince ourselves that it's not going to happen to mm-hmm. us. Well, they were just so out of control. And indeed, the first season, which I watched, I hadn't watched it, but I said, well, my agent called me about doing mm-hmm. the project. And I said, well, I didn't watch that last year, but I heard some unsettling things about it. It sounded like a kind of assassination of character mm-hmm. job. Can you send me some DVDs so I can at least see what they did? Well, it was obvious to me that it was really off the wall. I mean, it was a non-union crew, not that that's a big part of it, but it certainly contributes. Mm-hmm. And there were such egregiously horrible decisions made
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That one could only stand back and say, wow, well, that won't happen
mm-hmm.
to me or to us. In fact, all my regular crew worked on it.
Really?
And I gave them a very standardized spiel, each one of them. I said, now look, we work together on everything. I'd love to have you do this with me, but if you don't want to, I will understand.
It's a different circumstance.
I happen to think that we're smart enough to not fall into those traps. Now, that being said, I also learned something very important, that ultimately, if you're in front of the camera, and you're doing your job well, there's no way to protect yourself. Mm-hmm. You might think that you will put a different face forward, but if you really care about the job, you're going to make the movie no matter what.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, you end up having so much footage, and at the end of the day, you're trying to put out an entertaining product too, you know, so I understand.
Well, if you're going to put your name on it, you want it to be acceptable.
Well, miraculously, the movie actually turned out pretty good. Battle of Shaker Heights was actually pretty enjoyable to watch. Yeah, it's a pretty good movie. The last thing before we move on to Christmas Vacation, actually, I guess two things. So we were in Winston-Salem talking, and Tom, you are now a professor at the North Carolina School, University of North Carolina School of the Arts. Can you tell our listeners a little bit about your experience there, and how long have you been doing that?
I have been doing that since fall of 2008.
Oh, wow. Okay.
How did it come about?
It came about, actually, my interest in, if you will, academia, you know, came as a result of having gone down to Chapman University in Orange County. Mm-hmm. A TV director that I used to work with invited me to come down and lecture his classes, and Gil Bettman, very talented guy, and writes now quite a lot in the field of film education. Mm-hmm. And I always found that interesting. I did some stuff for University of California up in Santa Barbara, where we lived. We lived in Montecito for about 20 years. Mm-hmm. And I always liked the experience working with the students. And so now we flash forward. Gil called back one day and said, "Hey, you've been coming down to do the lecture thing. Would you be interested in a full-time position?" Mm-hmm. And I thought about it, and I said, yeah, sure. I mean, it doesn't hurt to apply. Yeah. So I applied and was the choice of the selection committee, and some pretty distinguished filmmakers on that committee, John Badham being one of them, mm-hmm. and Gil, of course. But then they decided not to expand the cinematography faculty at that time. Mm-hmm. But I got just enough feedback mm-hmm. to say, hey, this could be something I'd want to explore further. Jordan Kerner, mm-hmm. a producer and wonderful friend, had written a letter of recommendation on my behalf. He produced George of the Jungle. Mm-hmm. That was our first experience. And then later on, Snow Dogs with mm-hmm. Cuba Gooding and mm-hmm. James Coburn. It was Coburn's last film.
Oh, wow.
He, Jordan, just 2 years prior to this, had become the dean of the film school over at UNCSA.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
And also, in perfect sync, a job came up, an opening in the cinematography faculty here, for which I applied. I was down in New Orleans shooting a film called Mardi Gras, and I interviewed essentially on Skype. And then, just prior to that, I'd gotten an offer from NYU to go over to Tisch Asia. So the academic thing, which I turned down because mm-hmm. I had plenty of stamps in my passport, and it was and it was a great deal, mm-hmm. a lot of family travels, and indemnifying one against extra taxes in Singapore mm-hmm. and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, I passed on that. But when it came to UNCSA, and without ever having set foot on the campus, I decided to take the job. Really? My equation was relatively straightforward. I, of course, knew about the school, mm-hmm. which already had acquired a pretty good mm-hmm. or excellent reputation.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
mm-hmm. But my calculus was that if it's got Jordan Kerner's commitment, a smart man, a good man, mm-hmm. a man with a lot of taste, and I know from having worked on his movies, he cares about quality intensely. Mm-hmm. Good enough for me.
Yeah.
So I drove out as the financial markets were collapsing.
Wow.
Literally. Mm-hmm. To take a teaching job. Yeah. having turned down another feature, you know.
Yeah.
No, I don't want to get there and just turn right around. Now, part of my deal, mm-hmm. which made it work, mm-hmm. was that I didn't quit the day job.
Sure, sure.
I did not stop shooting movies for the simple fact that I couldn't and I can't.
Yeah.
It's part of me.
Yeah.
Secondly, the sort of the intellectual construct is I think it, for me, it makes me more relevant to my students.
Absolutely. Sure.
I think everybody approaches teaching a different way. That's my way.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way it's worked out.
Yeah, my brother, Adam, graduated from the School of the Arts in 05 with his degree in filmmaking. He was in the screenwriting discipline, but yeah. So I'm familiar with the program there. I've spent a lot of time on campus visiting him and actually got to see a few movies in the big old theater there.
So. Isn't that great? The only 70mm venue in North Carolina.
That's fine.
We're hoping to resurrect a 70mm film that I shot for Charles Guggenheim for Expo 84.
Really?
The school's not involved in the restoration. Mm-hmm. If it is funded, it will be through Guggenheim Productions. Mm-hmm. But we're certainly hoping to have a gala screening.
Mm-hmm.
It was a thing we did, you know, like I say, for Expo.
Wow, that's awesome. Well, we're going to move on into National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, the film for which Tom was the director of photography, correct? So we're going to kind of play through here as we talk a little bit. Now, I love the opening of this film. You don't see too many movies that have this cartoony title sequence, and I think it's...
Not anymore. Yeah.
I think I read somewhere or heard in an interview that this was one of like three or four or five films that year that had a similar opening. So maybe that was more of a thing of the time.
Huh. For me, I see this opening sequence, it's even though it's a Christmas movie, it's animation, I instantly go to Grease. I figure somebody who was a big fan of Grease was like, hey, I'm going to make a movie, and let's start it off with an animated sequence.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny. This is a film that I think, you know, so many people and families enjoy and love to watch at the Christmas season, and it's become a staple of the American household.
To me, we discussed this earlier, how much of a horror guy I am. to me, the four Christmas movies, I have four Christmas movies I make sure I watch every December. Christmas Story on Christmas Day because TBS plays it back to back to back, and you just sit there and just catch different pieces of it. This movie, Die Hard and Gremlins, are my four Christmas movies.
That's
your 80s guy, huh?
You could just slightly an 80s guy. So it's. I always make sure this has become a seminal movie for especially people my age. This is like one of our go-to Christmas movies. Period. Even my wife likes this movie, and she likes hardly any comedies. She's like, they're stupid. I don't get it. But even this movie, she likes.
Well, I think John Hughes, as the great storyteller, he was. Really got at family Christmas in such a truthful way. I mean, few people have had the extremes that are shown in the film, but they've had elements of those extremes.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yes.
Well, I think a lot of this is probably based on his actual experiences growing up. And, you know, the film itself is based on Christmas 59, the short story he wrote for National Lampoon magazine, which definitely seems very autobiographical. I read it yesterday. It seems very autobiographical. It's the narrator, the perspective of the son. And so the father in the story, who's actually part... Is you know, not the main character. He's a little bit different from Clark Griswold, but
well, I wonder how much of that started like that, and then when they hired Chevy Chase, it took on another. Just as we were talking about earlier, a different actor can take a movie in a different direction.
Oh, sure.
I wonder if they had somebody else in mind, or they were using the short story.
The reason I say that they didn't have another actor in mind, I think, was that, you know, it was going to be a National Lampoon production, and I think I'm just supposing that Chevy and Beverly were totally baked into it because they'd already done Vacation.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. Well, and Chevy was actually highly involved with the National Lampoon back in the 70s prior to Saturday Night Live. He was part of their acting troupe. Mm-hmm. And so I think he's just always kept close ties with those guys, and that naturally led to the Vacation, National Lampoon's Vacation, which I believe, I'm not 100% sure, is also based off of another John Hughes short story from the magazine.
Yeah.
I got to double check that, but I'm pretty sure that's and so that may actually be where Clark comes from. That may actually be John Hughes' dad, or at least the story dad. So, one thing I got to ask you about, and this is a thing that comes up almost every episode that we see it. I'm a huge fan of rear projection. I've used it in my first movie.
Yes, he is.
And I just love it. It's just anytime I see it. Can you tell us, as a cinematographer, about using rear projection? I mean, it's not something you see done much nowadays at all. It's all digital and blue screen or green screen.
Right, right. Well, it is certainly, there are a lot of creative freedoms involved, but there's a lot of tremendous restrictions to it.
Yeah.
I mean, every single shot that you see, like all the interior shots of the car, have to be preconceived, focal lengths chosen, and so that when you send the plate unit out, the second unit or plate unit, to shoot the backgrounds, the camera will be pointed in the right direction. You can see that very badly done.
And you're really at their mercy. They have to have gotten it just right in order for you to do your job. Well, and
I would rephrase that. They are at your mercy.
Okay.
I mean, they will, you know, they would not want to bring back plates that were done. Well, and what I do, I send them out with paperwork that makes it unmistakable as to where the lens will be pointed.
Okay, I see.
What focal lengths of lenses will be used. And, you know, lighting is very important. Mm-hmm. We can't control the sky.
Yeah.
And so the best way to shoot plates is before you shoot the studio stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the bad news is that you can't always do that. Sometimes you have to shoot, well, with rear screen, you always do that because you have to have the plate and then you put the actors in front.
Mm-hmm.
With blue screen or green screen, in theory, you can shoot the foreground first and then the plate, but then the tail is wagging the dog.
Yeah, sure.
The scene with the logging truck, we also had, like in this shot, the logs are actually in the studio. The spinning tires behind the car are in the studio.
That's great, yeah.
The proximity was such that those elements needed to be there,
sure,
and the rear screen behind that.
I see, yeah.
But
that's a hell of a car stunt, too.
Well, that was one of my first thoughts was was it a conscious idea to take a lot of this seems to be stunt work. I mean, all this is stunt work, but it seems to be a stunt comedy. I don't know, when you include Chevy Chase, you know you've got to have
a lot
of physical stuff.
Absolutely.
So how much of that played into was this kind of a throwback to the original movie where it's kind of a road movie?
Well, I think when you shoot stunts in this kind of a context,
yes,
there's a very fine line sometimes between what works as a gag and what goes too far.
Mm-hmm.
And you kill a guy, or it looks like, you know, right away what that line is. But there was quite a bit of stunt work in this as well as in Dennis the Menace, which I shot right after this.
Yeah.
Not right after, but it was the next Hughes film that I did. Or had, no, wait, that was first. I shot Dennis the Menace right before Christmas Vacation. Mm-hmm. And have you ever seen Dennis the Menace?
Yes.
With Chris
while,
Lloyd?
Chris Lloyd.
Oh, my God.
Guy, yeah. Dr. Matthau.
You know, when John Hughes writes a sequence of shots that involve Dennis firing a marble at a tree that bounces off, goes across a creek, and then we become the point of view of the marble heading for Chris Lloyd's butt, Switchblade Sam. those are challenging shots, and those were not CGI shots. Yeah. That was, you know, long after the snow had started falling, we had a they built a creek on a stage for us, and under the viaduct sequence with the campfire and everything, and we traveled the camera as if it were the marble.
That's used a lot in Rat Race too, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
No, Rat Race was another movie that road movie, of course, where there was a lot of physical comedy. If you remember, there's a scene where Polini, the character that's so brilliantly played by the British comic
Rowan Atkinson.
Rowan Atkinson. Yeah. And the character's name is Polini, mm-hmm. where he runs out into the street in Vegas and gets hit by the delivery van. And you see his trajectory, you know, very huge trajectory. Mm-hmm. And it's funny, but I guarantee you that there was only a hair's width between shooting it that way mm-hmm. and doing it in a way that would have not only been unfunny, but it would have stopped. It would have been the wrong genre entirely.
Yeah. Now, how much when you're shooting something like that, is it, I mean, it seems to me like a very, I know very little about filmmaking. I play on this side of the camera. Yes, I'm definitely learning. When you're shooting something like that, or something like the log truck scene here, and there is that fine line, can that line be as minute as your angle? Of the way you shoot it, how much input do you have as that guy to what it's? Do you understand what I'm trying to ask?
I would say that your question is hitting the right notes in every way except the adjective slight.
Okay.
It is generally not if something is fundamentally wrong with a shot, you're not going to correct it by slightly doing anything.
Gotcha.
Slightly moving the camera left, right, up, down an inch. You know, we'll go slightly longer on the lens, whatever. There's probably something far more fundamental than that to consider, and it's a complicated, multi-layered question because it's often. It's not hard, in my view, to shoot a joke so it works. But what it often has to do with is making sure that the elements of that joke are clearly seen.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that doesn't mean it has to be really hackneyed or mm-hmm. stupid or blatantly shot. Mm-hmm. It just means you got to see and be paying attention to the things that are the most important.
Well, what's intended has to come across.
Yeah, you have to see.
As intended, yeah.
The viewer has to see what
filmmakers want them to.
Yes, and it's your job to facilitate that. So if you're doing it from the wrong perspective, then it could completely screw the whole thing up.
Yeah, and it's also allowing the audience to share in the... to be part of the targeting mechanism. Now, this can work in any genre. It was, of course, done so brilliantly in the early sequences in Jaws, you know, where we are the shark.
Yeah.
Nobody has to say anything. You don't hear the shark's heart. You don't hear him mm-hmm. breathing. But we are definitely the shark, and everyone knows it.
Mm-hmm. That shot and that score, and that's it.
Yeah, it just all comes together. I believe we have coverage in Dennis of when the babysitter, Dennis's babysitter, they're rigging up a dumping water bucket and flour to fall onto Dennis because. Yep. There's a war going back and forth mm-hmm. between the babysitter and Dennis. The only problem is it's not Dennis pushing the doorbell with the thumbtack. It's Mr. Wilson. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so you have that. We see it from directly above, kind of like that shot in Carrie, you know, where you establish the bucket of blood and then a red paint. We are the targeting mechanism. Then comes the dump. You see it from a side angle, super cartoony. There comes the dump. And then, of course, the cut-in of Walter Matthau, just long enough for him to blow a puff of powder out of his flour out of his mouth. Yeah. These are all carefully mapped out and carefully shot. So I apologize for the long-winded answer, but jokes, I think, are probably...
I had a very vague question.
No. It was a good question, and it has led us to the conclusion that although there's no funny way to shoot, cinematography certainly and directing can provide the editor with the right beats so that the joke works.
Yes, gotcha.
I wanted to ask you, this is the Warner Brothers backlot, is that correct?
That's the backlot at Warner Brothers. We built that.
This is...
They built the whole set.
Look at that. Isn't that cool? And you know, I did a little bit of research on this, and it seems so familiar to me. Probably because I've watched this movie so many times, but also it was used in the Lethal Weapon movies, too.
That's right.
Oh, it's Martel's house.
That's
which funny. I love those movies. So, and they're both Warner Brothers, so I had to ask you about that. And all that's fake snow and ice, right? And well, I'm guessing so. It's Hollywood.
Yeah.
What is the snow made of? Is that like foam?
You know, I'm not. No. We had the snow banks.
Yeah.
Like where the snowplow's gone by and it's heaped up on the side of the road.
Yeah.
Those had understructure that were formed and. And it was obviously a physical material, plasticky stuff.
Yeah.
Then that would be dusted with a powdery snow-like substance, but there would be certain areas that would have real snow and real ice, and then they would blow the snow up onto the trees and so forth, so that it was really an enormous amount of work for the special effects guys.
Yes. Do you remember what time of year this was shot? Was it?
It was shot in the winter because I believe we went out to do the exteriors in Colorado first, and I think that was like in October or so, November, and then we came back. I believe we took a Christmas hiatus.
Okay. One thing I found pretty interesting when I was doing research on this is, from what I found, and correct me if you know better than I do, originally they had hired Chris Columbus to direct this picture. And from doing...
Really?
Well, I don't know.
He was around that early?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, well, yes.
Oh, wow. 89.
Oh, that's true.
From my research said that he didn't get along with Chevy Chase very well. After a couple of meetings, he just basically quit. And but kept in touch with John Hughes. I'd love to work with you on something. You know, I love doing this type of Christmas film. And he says, "Well, I've got something else for you." And that's when Home Alone came around. Another John Hughes, Christopher Columbus collaboration. So it's funny how those things work out. You know, you have one classic Christmas film that kind of has a weird way of kind of giving birth to this other classic Christmas film.
Well, and you really don't have to answer this, even though I don't think you'll ever hear it in any way, shape, or form. But Chevy Chase is known to be a little difficult to work with. Was that the case that you saw, or was he generally pretty? Was he okay?
Well, I think you have to.
We're not slinging mud around here.
No, I think you have to understand that fundamentally, an actor, especially a successful actor, and even more so an effective and successful actor, a comic actor, is going to be... He brings certainly some idiosyncratic values to the part, to the project. They're taking a tremendous risk. The sequence of Clark Griswold up on the extension ladder, stapling his arm to the
different kind of
house
risk.
That
yes.
will soon be festooned with Christmas lights. This is, you know, it's physical comedy, it's great acting, and to do this kind of stuff, you're under a tremendous amount of pressure.
Did he do a lot? Did he have a stunt guy, or did he do a lot of his...
We had a stunt guy, and the more rigorous stunts were done by the stunt guy.
Yeah.
But it's I think it's like you said, that, you know, especially an actor like that, it, that phase in his career, a lot's probably riding on a film like this, you know, to you know, he has a lot of investment in making sure that one of these films, these vacation films, or, you know, any other film that he stars in, you know, goes the way he wants it to. You know, I can understand.
Absolutely.
So it's everybody.
I don't necessarily fault him, but that is part of his reputation from, you know, everything I've seen, that he's you know, difficult. But
no, you have a tremendous investment in it.
Sure.
And to think that the success of the film is not resting heavily on your shoulders would be a mistake.
Absolutely.
It's not a punch the time clock type of job.
Sure.
And so therefore, I think that if anyone, you know, has a lapse on a set, and I think we probably all do, they kind of need to be forgiven for it. Now, there's a difference between having a lapse, because oftentimes, you know, you're losing the sun. You got to motivate people to
move your ass. We got to get this done.
Let's go, boys and girls. you know, as to whether any lines were crossed, I'm not the one to.
Yeah,
I'm not going to judge.
Well, that wasn't what I was looking for.
I know. I just,
give us some dirt.
Well, no, I mean, I was.
You asked a question.
We do, and we talk about this all the time because we're very, very, very amateur filmmakers.
Yeah.
We've seen the difference in our shooting, whether it's been a fun set or not fun set, you know, whether it's been stress-filled or not. Mm-hmm. You know, so that was kind of more what I was looking for, was how fun was the set to work on as a whole. Or do you even pay any attention to that stuff whatsoever?
Well, if you pay attention to everything.
Yeah.
And a film set, by its very nature, whether it be a low-budget indie movie or a very large-budget studio film, which has been my... Those types of projects have been my mainstay. Mm-hmm. You feel the pressure.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay.
But not in a way that takes over. And in fact, one of the things you have to do if you're playing any kind of a role at all, certainly in a key part in the production of the film, is you have to learn to tune that out. And you can't let it drive the process. That being said, you know, it's something that the crew, ultimately, you ask if the crew is a good barometer of how funny or how... If you were to try to gauge the effectiveness of a film by a crew's response to dailies, by how much, quote, fun they were having on the set... By the way, sets can be fun. They can be filled with... You know, a solidarity that everyone working feels like they're going to the same thing. They're friends. They've done my crew. I've worked with them on lots and lots of movies. But
that's a running theme with us. You work with the people you like to work with.
Yes, but as far as their acting as a barometer, I would say it's the inverse.
Okay.
I have heard so many crews come out of dailies and, you know, just, oh, that's awesome. Well, you know, it's like, we'll see. We'll see about that. You can't tell, and I can't tell.
Yeah.
At this time.
A lot of steps between now and then.
Well, yeah, and the editors and post and sound and all that stuff has to be added in afterwards. So, yeah, it could change something.
Well, and the fact is that the people who are ultimately charged with making it work are the director and the editor and the producer, to a large extent, if they're a very hands-on producer. They're the ones who are going to have to pull this all together. And the dolly grip is really, as well they should be, very gratified when the crane shot works beautifully.
Yeah.
I love the lighting. As to whether the stories or the jokes are coming off, it's really hard to tell.
Yeah. But that's your expertise, though. You know, that's what you're getting paid to is to be there to do is to make sure the lighting is right and make sure that the shots are the way you want them. And so, yeah, I mean, I think it makes total sense to look at it and say that's the way we anticipated. And
you are the analogy I make is when you sign on to do a movie in any job category, mm-hmm. but certainly in a key role, it's like when a lawyer hires on to defend a client or represent a client uh-huh. in court.
Sure.
The minute you sign on to do that, you agree that you will put all thoughts of the alternate universe aside. Mm-hmm. You will consider mitigating evidence only in favor of your client, mm-hmm. and you will do everything humanly possible to represent them. Same way with a movie. When I sign, I'll do all my consideration when I'm reading the script.
Yeah, sure.
And when I'm taking the meeting with the directors and the producer. Once I sign on, I will do anything that I humanly can to make that
sure.
work, my purview mm-hmm. work.
What do you look for when you're reading a script and when you're having those initial meetings with producers and directors with trying to decide whether or not a project's for you and you want to sign on to it and give everything you have to it. It's like, as a director, like if I'm meeting with somebody and what are they looking for?
What I'm looking for obviously is chemistry. That's mm-hmm. a big part of it. Am I the right guy for them? Mm-hmm. Do I like their body of work? Mm-hmm. Do I respect them, their body of work? Mm-hmm. And are they, will we have mutual chemistry that will get us through each of the long, hard days that are ahead? Mm-hmm. You know, I look at the sequence you just showed of the attic. Mm-hmm. Chevy up in the attic having had the pull down.
Yeah.
The stairway, close yeah. him off, and he's sitting up there in his mom's old mink coat and hat. He's sitting up there in his mom's old mink coat and hat, watching black and white 8mm home movies. Mm-hmm. A little moist eye.
Yeah.
And the next day, after the dailies had been seen in Chicago, Jeremiah Chechik, the director, and I, and the producers got a wonderful note from John Hughes mm-hmm. citing each one of us. And my part of it was, Tom, thanks again. You made it look like every attic I've ever imagined.
It's true.
And I hate that we skip forward, but that is actually a very pivotal scene of the film. It's really, I think, the point where Clark has this realization that he has to make this Christmas perfect for everybody. He wants to have the perfect family Christmas. It's a good turning point in the film, as opposed to just, you know, deciding to stay home for vacation for once, you know.
Yeah.
But it's a nice little scene too, where you can see some of his family history, including characters that will come back later in the film, which is kind of fun to see. One thing I think we'd be remiss if we didn't mention this wonderful cast. What an amazing cast! Oh, I mean, yes. Everyone always says Chevy Chase, but I mean, he is the focal point. But all these incredible supporting actors, especially the grandparents,
yeah. E.G. Marshall, John Randolph, both of actors. Those guys. That we see
yeah.
on the front doorsteps as Clark is making another failed effort to light up the house. They were both in the cast of 12 Angry Men.
Wow, for yeah, Sidney Lumet. Right. I forgot about that. I didn't even Doris Roberts, Diane Ladd. Yeah, great, great actors. And not even mention his kids, John Galecki and Juliette Lewis. Yes.
An amazing cast.
His second version of Kids, which turned into third version of Kids, which turned into a fourth version of Kids, which is hilarious. But the fact that they've got those two playing the kids at that time, that's probably the best two known.
It's hilarious, yeah.
Now, because of Johnny Galecki with Big Bang So it's pretty funny.
Since we brought it up, I think we should we should mention the rest of the Vacation franchise started, I think, what, 83 with Vacation?
Something like
with
that,
the, yeah. With the trip to Wally World. A very funny R-rated comedy, which is a bit of a departure from this film. But and then they followed up with European Vacation, which in the history of it, I guess, it gets kind of overlooked. A lot of people, they don't care for it as much as the others. I like it. I think it's a pretty funny film. They're all funny.
83. You're right.
Was it? And yeah. This is 89. Yeah. I'm sure when Vegas Vacation came out, and sometime in the mid-90s.
I don't know, but that's one of, that's almost one of my favorite ones. I love it. Because I'm such a big... We're going to Vegas the second weekend in December, so...
That's probably why I've seen the movies, too.
That movie cracks me up, especially the sequence in the low-rent casino with him. They're playing war and pick a number and all this kind of stuff. It just cracks me up.
Have you seen the new one?
No, that I have not, and I hear it's really good.
I enjoyed it a lot. Have you seen the new Vacation? It's not, it is a reboot, but it's not a remake. Chevy Chase and Beverly D'Angelo are in it as Clark and
Beverly D'Angelo. Beverly.
Well, I know, but I can't remember the character's name. Griswold. And the kids have been recast this time as Ed Helms and. What's her name? It's going to kill me. I'll think of her playing the daughter. But anyways, I'll come
see,
back.
See, if we were going to talk dirt about somebody, Randy Quaid would have been the perfect guy who has gone completely off the reservation.
But hell of an actor.
This,
he is incredible in these movies.
That character is one of my favorite characters of all time.
He's great.
I still say to this day, I'll walk out of the bathroom and just go, shutter's full, you know? Because that line and that just cracks me up.
This is a classic now, podcast.
This is
Leslie Mann pays Audrey. I'm sorry.
getting back to before I go completely off the reservation, a lot of your stuff has been confined to a single house. Dennis and Menace is kind of, it's a little bit outside exteriors, but it's kind of the house thing. This is primarily in that house. Jumanji was primarily in that house. What is the difference between shooting in a more confined space like that versus a big open space or a road trip like Rat Race?
Great question, and one that has very rarely, if ever, been presented to me in this kind of a, you know, chat that we're having. There are enormous challenges in making a house into a character, mm-hmm. because normally, or what that would suggest is that there are going to be a lot of pages of script and story happening in a relatively confined space. It's a big set. Jumanji was a huge set.
Yeah.
But the house becomes a character.
Yeah.
And very often the house interiors almost always will be done on stage, which means that you have just physical issues like this is on a location exterior, this is stage exterior, this is location interior, this is stage interior. You get into a 3D chess kind of situation. Mm-hmm. Creatively, it's great because everyone can make it exactly what they want. Mm-hmm. But particularly in an ensemble comedy like this, mm-hmm. and right now we're seeing the entire joined family with Randy Quaid and his lovely wife and the kids out there on the front lawn. Now, you imagine them going into that house and more specifically into the entry foyer. It was brutal covering it in terms of setting up and composing the close-ups, blocking the action, lighting. And that's with all the advantages of a studio set.
Well, and I noticed that you said that. I noticed what the scene where the grandparents are introduced, it kind of moves to a handheld scene. Is that,
yeah.
Which is kind of a departure from the rest of the film. It kind of gives you this little claustrophobic look of they're intruding and they're in the middle of this family.
It was to induce some claustrophobia. It was it also a part, and it was Jeremiah Chechik's thought, the director, that it will give, it'll just give an edge to it, uh-huh. infuse a bit of helter-skelter that the more traditional kinds of camera moves yeah. had not done. And ultimately it was also, practically speaking, you got 8 or 9 people in that foyer, yeah. and if the camera operator needs to slide left or right, a little forward or backward, to be to help the other dancers, mm-hmm. you know, they can do that.
I was watching it, going, that must have been a nightmare to edit with all the conversations going on and all the.
Yes,
I'm sure it was.
All the back and forth. And
But you mentioned Randy Quaid, and I, he is so perfect in this role. I mean, he's a hell of an actor. Anything he's been in, I mean, I know he hasn't done a whole lot of acting here lately, but.
But you know,
Wally World Glass. We got to mention that.
You see him, and it's
the Dickie.
His acting, you see that. Run across everything he's done, even if it's not Cousin Eddie, you mm-hmm. see that character. So it's we go back to this a lot too. It seems like the best actors are their person just turned to 15.
Well, there's a genuineness and an authenticity about Cousin Eddie that is the reason he works. He's not just a cartoon character. Like, he's somebody you yeah. know. Everybody yeah. knows a guy like this. Yeah. I can think of a couple. I'm not going to list their names on this podcast. But,
just an unintended, wild, destructive force mm-hmm. that you want to just love, but you just can't because he's just so
yeah.
bad.
A couple of... We'll start skipping through this a bit more. We're only halfway through the film at the introduction of Cousin Eddie, or reintroduction, I should say. He's been in other, or at least the first film. A couple of common threads between this film and Brian Doyle Murray, another National Lampoon.
Had you seen the first two movies? Did you watch them to prepare for this one, or did you? Do you shy away from that, or?
You know, I've never. Am I right in saying I've never done a sequel mm-hmm. based on what somebody else had shot, except for this.
Oh, really?
And I hope I'm right in saying that. But in any case, I generally think of what we're doing as we're breaking ground mm-hmm. and we do what we do.
Yeah.
In this one, what was the Home Alone? I mean, no, the what was the vacation movie prior to this?
European vacation, I believe, yeah. was the second one.
I didn't screen it, no.
Yeah.
And I also felt probably that lack of diligence is not commendable, but I felt that there were so many fundamental differences in terms of
sure.
the production design,
mm-hmm.
the intent of the photography between this and what was essentially a European road trip.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is the only film where they stay home. This is the
vacation at home
yeah.
instead of traveling.
I had to play this. I'm sorry. This is a little bit more rear projection. I was like, yes.
Well, this is a lot of rear projection.
Oh, Walmart. I've been watching a lot of James Bond lately, and almost every Roger Moore is about 50% projection film. He doesn't get out of the studio.
That's funny.
Anyways, several common threads between this and Christmas 59 from the National Lampoon magazine was the dad's or Clark's bonus, which comes at the end of the film as kind of like this climactic ending where he's. It sets up the climactic ending when he sees the disappointment that happens at the very beginning of the story, and it's he's given something really stupid, but yeah, he's pissed off. That starts off the Christmas. His dad's pissed off about his bonus, so he's not nearly as likable in the story.
Always got to be a hot girl.
Yeah, this is the girl from earlier in the film too.
And at the Christmas
at the counter. Yeah. There's also
I was going to ask if you were to completely degrade myself in front of you and to show you that I'm. I was going to ask if you went, why did I not get the one where Beverly D'Angelo became topless?
I never questioned like, which, that. I try not to go down that road.
Yeah, I got you. I'm a terrible joke maker too.
this whole last act of the film pretty much takes place in the home on Christmas Eve night, and it's a very story wise packed full of things happening. The rest of the film is kind of all over the place with you know characters being introduced here, them going places, doing shopping, doing things, but the final act starts with their having Christmas Eve dinner, and they cut open the turkey in it.
There's nothing.
It's like
in
a deflated
it.
Yes. Football. the cat getting into the Christmas tree, yep. getting
electrocuted,
which I think was that kind of a do you remember that being kind of a taboo thing or not? Not sure if they wanted to go that far.
Or isn't this the one? Is this the one where Grandma sends the cat and the Christmas present?
It is, but then the cat gets out and gets electrocuted.
Yeah.
Interesting that you should ask that question because we recently adopted a cuddly, wonderful, little, great little kitty.
I'm sure you'll treat it.
And I was thinking, wow. 25 years ago, we were electrocuting a cat in a John Hughes movie. But you know, honestly, it was not. It didn't seem taboo. It seemed in bad taste.
Yeah.
Intentional bad taste. Intentional bad taste. And it was a taboo to actually show a smoldering aftermath of a cute little cuddly cat.
What should have been a carcass?
Well, hell, they killed Grandma in the first film.
Well, that's true too.
And so that's followed up by Clark getting the bad news about his bonus and having this breakdown, which I think is an epic scene. Well,
very good acting in the scene, by the way. Very, very excellent work on Chevy's part.
A lot of intensity.
Now, how was a lot of this scripted, or did they just kind of turn him loose?
My recollection is that this was scripted with some improv.
Okay.
Once he really loses it.
Mm-hmm.
But it was very, very, very tight to the script. You know, usually on Ackerman, for example, we would do Adam's and Judd's version of the script,
mm-hmm.
and then it would, and then Will would, and the other actors would go off into improv land, but not, and I think this is the secret of great improv,
mm-hmm.
they didn't veer off too wildly. In other words, the story points were the same, the intent was the same, the flavor. They just made it funnier.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And
but you got guys like that. I mean, I'm sure they could make it funnier than what was scripted, and that's probably what they anticipated when writing the script was, you know, we'll use this joke for now, but we'll see what they come up with on the set. It may be actually better. And
I was just curious because a lot of the stories you hear about those SNL guys were that when they went and did movies, it was a lot of unscripted stuff and a lot of ad-libbed. And
I read somewhere researching this, that rant they had actually put. Do you recall this at all? Maybe it's cue cards for him during his rant. That's an SNL thing. I mean, because the whole script for the show is on cue cards. Yeah. But I don't know why I had read that somewhere that. If they were stapled on the wall or something like that, so he could.
No, not in this case. not
he's
in the movie.
A good actor to remember his lines.
Yeah, no, Chevy did not work with cue cards at all.
You could staple cue cards to my forehead, and I'd still forget my lines.
Well, I forgot to mention the fireball that took out the Christmas tree, and his dedication to Christmas. He's going to go get another tree, by God. A squirrel-infested tree.
Yeah.
It's again anything that can go wrong at Christmas has gone wrong mm-hmm. at Christmas.
The person with the worst hearing in the household hears the squeaking squirrel.
tremendous.
Squirrel.
Is this a real squirrel?
Now, how is it?
Is this is this like a puppet or?
Yeah. Well, that's real. That was a puppet. That's a puppet.
So it's cut back and forth.
How is it working with an ensemble versus a smaller group?
Casting me?
Yes.
Well, working with an ensemble for the cinematographer carries its own set of challenges just because of body count. I mean, you've got all these people. Now they're running from the squirrel. They're all clotted up in the near the staircase. And in terms of how they move, how the action flows, where the camera goes, how it's lit, it can be quite challenging.
And now this very satisfying payoff with the squirrel and the dog, Snots, that attacks Julia Louis-Dreyfus. Yeah. She goes to complain.
Gone.
I've been seeing a lot of T-shirts. For some reason, this movie's been out for so long and so many merchandise and memorabilia, Christmas ornaments, all kinds of stuff. This year, for some reason, I've been seeing T-shirts that say, "I don't know, Margot."
Oh, really?
Christmas sweater style shirts. It just this goes to speak to the enduring quality of this film. Clark's breakdown continues.
And everybody else is just curmudgeonly looking at him going, "Nope."
Jolliest bunch of assholes this side of the nut house. You're goofy.
You're goofy. It's a great
this is
line.
Reminiscent of a similar rant in Vacation when they're halfway to Bally World. Mm-hmm. The kids want to turn around. And he's like, "No,
yep.
This is happening. Put a freaking smile on your face."
And he always goes on a rant in these movies, which is kind of part of the Vacation.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the right word I'm looking for is. They do certain stuff in every mm-hmm. Vacation movie, and it's kind of the...
This is a great scene between Chevy and John Randolph.
Yeah, it's a great scene where he's kind of giving him permission to be upset, but also you got to... This is, you have to step up and... Yes. And
are you going to recite The Night Before Christmas?
No. It's your house. It's your Christmas.
Find it. I don't know. I don't think ironic is the word, but I find it weird that you look at the history of Christmas movies, and almost all of them, especially family Christmas movies, all of them are about dad not getting a bonus or getting a weird Christmas present like Christmas Story, or getting stepped on Christmas Carol with Tiny Tim, and how he's. His dad's held under the guy's thumb, and it's Christmas movies are always based around somebody getting held down, or somebody getting a crappy Christmas present, or something from their bosses, who most time you never see. But it's almost like a Christmas story has to come from being just super down to bring it back
satisfied
up.
With life. I mean, that's a common thread.
I guess it's kind of the arc, films. The story arc.
And there's quite a few parallels, I think, to this film and It's a Wonderful Life. I mean, that's certainly one where George Bailey is very dissatisfied with life. I mean, to the point where he's gotten almost suicidal before he's given this wonderful opportunity to see what the world would be like without him. And I think there's a couple of literal nods to in this film, especially the staircase banister top that wiggles. That I think he cuts off with a chainsaw. I think it's a literal nod to It's a Wonderful Life. I think Frank Capra III worked on this film too. Second AD, is that correct?
Yeah.
And
here's the thing. I when it comes to Christmas,
mm-hmm.
And I think John Hughes captured this very, very well. He, by the way, the master storyteller.
Mm-hmm.
He, the master conduit of the Midwestern sensibility.
Mm-hmm.
But he knew, and I think we all know, that everybody feels pressure
at Christmas time,
sure. Because it is established as the quintessential family celebration, the quintessential gift giving, and in a larger sense, making things right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Making things better than they ever could be during the year.
Yeah.
And in many cases, making promises that can't be kept.
Yeah.
Or implying things that are impossible. So that's why this works, I think, among many reasons, and the fact that the jokes are awesome.
Well, and thankfully, at the end, after the police have raided the house, which is a hilarious scene, and they've Brian Dwayne Murray's admitted his mistake, and then the entire family and the police force and the kidnapped boss is all in the front yard when the explosion happens.
from Eddie pumping waste into the yeah. sewer.
But there's a moment I would just this is the very last line of the film. I think it kind of gets to what Tom was saying and kind of wraps everything up when he takes a deep sigh of relief and says, "I did it." You know, like he's pulled off the perfect family Christmas day he wanted to in the end.
This is so out of left field. When she just starts singing.
Like you're saying the Pledge of Allegiance at during grace.
Again, you're having to do a shot with a large group of people and kind of give you... Chevy's got to be the focal point, but everybody's kind of got to have their moment too because it's so many of these great actors.
No, there's a lot of scenes with, and my, you know, the performer count here is unrivaled, you know, yeah. in terms of
sure.
the complexity of it. But ultimately, you know, making any film, you carve it out shot by shot,
mm-hmm.
day by day. The key thing being that you're making the same movie. You don't depart stylistically
yeah.
because the conversation or the blocking or the moment is too challenging, and you just march on, and
sure.
in this case we had so many wonderful performers, so many that made such a huge contribution.
Absolutely.
Really, really, really great folks to work with.
Well, I think that's going to wrap up our conversation on National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation. One last question. I'm going to keep it very brief because we're kind of running out of time here. But I was always wondering how involved was National Lampoon in the making of this film? As far as I can tell, there wasn't a whole lot going on at the magazine at that point. Was it just Matty Simmons as the executive producer? Was that the biggest involvement?
To my knowledge... to my knowledge, there was certainly no day-to-day oversight
mm-hmm.
that we were aware of.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure that the National Lampoon folks were watching dailies, and
mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure that they would have had a great interest in the outcome. But ultimately, my sense was they bought off on a great script.
Yeah.
They trusted John,
mm-hmm. who had been one of the contributors too.
Yes,
so they already knew him, and
yeah.
they knew that John Hughes was going to make a wonderful movie.
And this is the third film in the series, so the characters are already firmly established. So, yeah, I was just curious because I mean, from what I could tell,
you didn't have to reestablish them, which makes
yeah.
yeah.
From what I could tell, they were heavily involved with Animal House and the first Vacation, but you know, I just couldn't find much about further films with the name National Lampoon. You know, you just never know if it's actually just a title thrown up there from the studio or if they were actually heavily, you know, it's just as a viewer, I'm just curious.
Well, as a guy on set, it was not apparent to me
yeah.
that there was a really heavy-handed presence.
Yeah.
But then again, I wouldn't accuse them of wanting to be heavy-handed.
Sure.
They had a winning combination.
You got to trust these people. These are good people. You're working on your film.
Call, you know, John on the phone and say, I think we ought to backpedal this scene around the... It's a little too heavy, this deal around the tree with the, you know, the cat being electrocuted.
You can't electrocute cats, man. What are you doing? No.
Yeah.
So Tom, short of filling out an application to be a student at your school and going through that process. how can our listeners get more Tom Ackerman? Where should they go?
I have a question first, though.
All right, go ahead.
I have a short question. It's kind of a cinematography question. I've seen the cinematographers that we have worked with seem to also have a very keen eye for photography. Is that something that comes before the cinematography side, or after, or do they just kind of go hand in hand?
That's a good question. And actually, I asked a version of that. In fact, this morning I asked a version of that to incoming students, potential candidates that want to be cinematographers. Mm-hmm. And it's basically, have you ever shot any pictures? Have you done any photography? Mm-hmm. And I don't mean selfies, although you can do some wonderful... Look, you can do such wonderful work with a cell phone. Mm-hmm. It's really been a great tool for me, and I've done some very serious work on it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But the question is, what comes first? And in my mind, good taste and an awareness and moreover an appreciation and a love of images comes first.
Sure.
Ideally, you will have practiced the art of photography and the craft of photography before you start weighing yourself down with working on a film. Because all of a sudden, as you guys know, the privacy, the independence that you have as a photographer when you're wandering around in the woods or in your studio with two or three lights vanishes pretty much. And even on a little indie movie, you're a servant of many masters, and you've got to work through quite a few humans to get your vision happening. And you've got to speak that language. Mm-hmm. And you've got to be technically a craftsperson. And so it's a whole different process. I think that there's also, you know, an aspect that is baked in. Mm-hmm. If someone has no appreciation of the art form, has no visual sense, would be very hard to teach them anything. But if they have the right stuff, it might be masked, it might be unrealized, they themselves might not know that they have the potential. But as long as they do have some potential, you can take them to places that they might not have gone otherwise. That's what I think my role is. So does that answer your question?
I think so, yeah.
I think it's terribly important to be a photographer before you are a cinematographer. And that, again, as I say, it might mean having an innate way of looking at things that will translate to cinematography. The big difference between still photography and motion picture photography is that very fact. A still photographer will craft a single moment in time when one spot, one lighting condition, one perspective, and in
almost
film,
in total control.
And in film, you're going to be you're going to be all over the place.
Yeah.
I was camera operator for Vittorio Storaro on Francis Coppola's One from the Heart, which, if you haven't seen it, I recommend it. It was not his highest grossing film; probably was his lowest grossing film, but it was a thing of great beauty. Mm-hmm. Produced right after they came back from the Philippines on Apocalypse. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There's one dolly shot on this film, which was visually lavish beyond anything that people had seen at that time, and it encompasses about 7 minutes of of action with 35 different dolly moves and
wow.
with light changes and going from one apartment into another apartment with the actors. And that was certainly a case of Vittorio having to convey with light and with camera movement mm-hmm. a huge swath of the film.
Wow.
Very challenging.
I'm sure.
Well, you know, I wandered around in the woods with a camera dressed as a clown, and all it got me was arrested.
You gotta watch the clown stuff.
You gotta watch the clown stuff. So if our listeners want to see more of your work or what you're up to, what would you recommend? What's the best avenue to do that?
Let's see. Go out and buy a DVD of Alvin 4, The Road Trip.
All right.
I directed second unit on that.
All right.
It's a fun movie
uh-huh.
if they want to see that. They got to have 6 to 9 year olds
sure.
handy to
yeah.
legitimize the purchase and the viewing
Absolutely.
Decision. But I don't know what the, it's a little too early for me to say what I'll be doing this summer.
Sure.
Probably will involve a feature, it generally does in
yeah.
the summer. There is other things. So, for example, I'm actually contemplating doing seriously and for hire some still photography.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I've done some charity work, you know, where I'd donate a silent auction item that would involve portraiture,
mm-hmm.
you know, family moments, whatever. And there's been a great response to that. And I don't have all the time in the world, but I sure enjoyed it. And if I can make that happen for more folks, then I will do so.
Wonderful.
So stay tuned.
How would they contact you to?
There's nothing to contact
okay.
yet. I'm not going to have them call
gotcha.
The Gersh Agency
gotcha.
Because the rate card would be too
would be
daunting.
Yes,
but I'll find a user friendly way, and
sure.
in due course, maybe I'll let you guys know, and we'll talk about that venture in
That's
a little
cool.
in more detail. But thank you for asking because it is something yeah. I would love to do.
Sure,
I feel that, and we have some talented folks in the area, but by and large. Images shot for families are grossly bland
yeah.
and undermanaged.
Yeah.
You can look at one portfolio and it is much like the other, and it all involves putting an umbrella of light over the right over the camera lens and saying smile
mm-hmm.
and oh, be sure to wear your pretty dress or your nice new suit, right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
There's nothing that you can discern that separates one. And yet, every family is here for a certain span, and they live and they have events together that are very, very meaningful. They build houses that and put that roof over the family's head. They take... They have lives that could and should be celebrated
sure.
in a more observant way,
yeah.
photographically, than just going down to the guy and he rolls down a seamless paper that he bought at B&H.
Absolutely.
Well, my family portrait would be us lined up on the sofa in Beetlejuice in the acceptance office. With the guy with the shrunken head on this side, and
we could arrange that. Yeah. Actually, what a great!
You've got a lot of stuff here. We could do that.
Well, yes. You've got so much eye candy here that we could exploit.
You have no idea. We'll walk back into the office before we leave.
Yeah, I'd love to see your stuff.
Well, Tom, thank you so much for coming on the show. It's been a real treat to have you on, and it's certainly a change of pace for this podcast. We have friends on. We have other people who've worked in film before, but no one on the professional level that you have.
Local people doing
yeah,
stuff.
Which, all local filmmakers, but we really do appreciate you coming and giving your insights and thoughts on this film.
You're very kind, both of you. I've enjoyed talking to you.
Same
Great
here.
Questions. And
he's
we'll do it again
3 times now.
High five.
Sammie, where can our listeners find you?
Well, by the time this comes out, we will be neck deep, hopefully, in the midst of the screening of our documentary, Sammie the Comic Book Man.
Yeah.
So please, if that's at a local theater, please check it
look
out.
Look it up.
Yes, look it out. Look it up. So you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Sammie Castle. Sammie Castle Facebook, Sammie the Comic Book Man Facebook page.
Yeah. Yeah, like I said, we've already done a couple of screens, but we'll have several more throughout the triad in different states. So make sure to keep a lookout for that. You can email us at wreakhavocproductions@gmail.com. You can find me on Twitter at Hank versus the Undead, and check out our website, wreakhavocproductions.com. I think we have to mention this is the last episode of the year, and this will mark our first full year of doing this podcast. Our first episode launched January 1st of this year, so this will be a first full year. So congratulations, Sammie.
Yay, congratulations. Yeah,
thanks. And we
this was your brain trust. I'm just the mouthpiece and marketing guy.
I'm just glad we get a chance to do it. It's been a lot of fun, and hope
I do like to talk.
Guys, no. hope you guys have enjoyed it, and we look forward to coming back next year with some really great episodes and some great guests. So, happy holidays, Merry Christmas, and Happy New Year.
There we go.
Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. Vixen and Blitzen, all his reindeers pulling on the rein. Bells are ringing, children singing, all is merry and bright. Hang your stockings and say your prayers, 'cause Santa Claus comes tonight.